You can turn to Hebrews if you're following along in your Bible, or get the outline out, has the scripture reading on it as well. Continuing our sermon series in that book that we've been in for a while now, we're at the last chapter, Hebrews 13, and here we're told how we ought to conduct ourselves as we go with the people of God to God our Father's house. How should we live as those who are in company with his people going to his house? The general instructions about our pilgrimage were given to us in chapter 12. We're pilgrims in this world, you see. We're going somewhere else. We're going to God's inheritance that he has for us. And the opening exhortation for this is in Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. I'm going to read that to you first to just remind you where we are. He says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, talking about the people in the Old Testament that had faithfully served God, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So Jesus, by that work that he did going to the cross, is the one who wonderfully opened the way for sinners to come to God. It's by his incarnation, by becoming one of us. The Hebrews talks about all these things. By his suffering as our high priest, offering himself for our sins, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, where he went up into the very place of God's dwelling, and his intercession for us now as our priest in his Father's house, sitting at his Father's right hand. He made himself one of us, and then as our great high priest, he suffered for our sins to secure our pardon. Now he is before the Father, gathering all of his people to himself in faith, bringing them to trust in him and keeping us and preserving us as we go along till we obtain that glorious inheritance. We were advised in chapter 12 to expect hard things along the way. We have sin that needs to be purged, broken loose from us, and that can be painful and requires trials and sufferings many times. So the world also is opposed to those who are true to God, to those who love God and serve him. So we have opposition from those that are displeased with us. We were admonished then to persevere, recognizing that we would have challenges as we go along in the company of God's people, the church, enjoying the salvation that Jesus gives us. Chapter 13, then, where we are now, tells us how to conduct ourselves, again, as God's people, who for the rest of our days are en route to glory. That's where we're going. That's our destination. What a joy and delight it will be when we get there. But until we do, how are we to live with one another? How are we to live in this world? Now I read to you, I will read to you, starting at Hebrews 13:1. We've already looked at the first four verses, so we're going to be especially focusing on verses 5 and 6 today. So I'm going to read from verses 1 to 6, just to give you the context again. So here is the word of God, Hebrews 13, beginning in verse 1. Let brotherly love continue. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing some have unwittingly entertained angels. Remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are in the body also. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled, but fornicators and adulterers God will judge. And then the part we're looking at this week, verse 5, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? May God be pleased to add his blessing to his holy and infallible word. So verse 5, you see, begins with this command to let your conduct be without covetousness. Here we see that there is no place for covetousness among those who are going up to God's house. It doesn't belong with those people. It doesn't belong in the church of God. First, let's look at the meaning of the words, let your conduct be without covetousness, and then we'll move from there. So what is covetousness? The word that's used here is not the one that is most commonly translated covetous or don't covet or that sort of thing. This one especially focuses on being a money lover. It's literally a silver lover. And of course, their form of money was silver. So it's talking about being a money lover. And it has a negative prefix to it. So it's basically literally no money lover. It's saying be no money lover. It's all one word. It refers then to the sinful desire to have more than God has given you, along with a lack of gratitude or appreciation for what He has provided. And of course, that speaks into many aspects of our lives. The word that's translated conduct here speaks of our normal state or condition, sort of our default mode. Okay, it's not just a one-time behavior. It's sort of like where I'm kind of riding, you know, where do I live? You know, what should that be like? So it refers also, this word particularly is different than the one that we sometimes have that talks about our walk or our conversation with God, our way of living with God. This one includes the mind in particular. So it refers to both our frame of mind as well as our manner of living. Okay, not just what I think one day or something, but it's my, what is my frame of mind and what is my living? What is it like? It should be free of covetousness. This sin is one that can be hidden from others. So it can be in you, in your mind, and other people may not be able to detect it. It can ruin your soul, rot you from the inside. So it's very dangerous in that regard. Some sins are very open, like adultery. You know, that's going to be something that's going to be seen. Drunkenness, you know, those kind of things. I mean, people can try to hide those things, but they're much more open. It can debase your mind, you see, covetousness, and make you useless, where you're not able to plan or to think about the things that you ought to be thinking about because you're consumed with what you have and what you don't have. Instead of having communion with God, your mind is spinning in its quest to obtain more, to gain more, to have more, to outdo other people, whatever it is, it's kind of driving it. Or it can be another kind of a manifestation of it, or another kind of acting in your heart, a wallowing in disappointment, seething perhaps with envy that other people, well, why do they have those? Why do I not have what they that kind of a thing? Paralyzed, perhaps, with worry and care. What's going to happen? What about my retirement? How am I going to make ends? What am I going to do? You know, this kind of a preoccupation. In either case, it drags you down so that you're preoccupied and you're unable to care about other people. You have a little regard for them because you're so worried about your own situation or so desirous to go in and excel and beat out that and you even are ignorant of the true needs of your own soul because it consumes you from within. Just like lust does of any kind, covetousness is of course kind of a lust that goes into all areas of our life. Nor are you able to meditate on God because your heart is meditating on your property or your acquisition of property. However, this is also a sin that can be very, very evident and often is evident on the outside. I said it could be hidden away, but usually it can be seen pretty well. And it's evident from your complaining, from your fretfulness, from the things that you're obviously preoccupied with as you associate with others. It can be manifested with anger, or because of what you didn't get or what you lost or missed an opportunity or whatever it might be, or your reluctance, it's seen by your reluctance to minister to others. Sometimes people may not know why you're reluctant to minister to others or why you don't seem to care about others, but it may be what is seen outwardly, your inability to bear hardships. When difficulties come, you're just completely, because your whole focus is on what you have. Something happens to your precious loot, and then you're greatly disturbed by that. Owen calls it a vice that, he says, interestingly, as the light of nature shows. You don't even have to have the Word of God to see this. And he's referring to the fact that lots of the philosophers that didn't know God, they would talk about the problem of this. We don't hear that very much now in our society. It's sort of looked at something that's not really a problem. But in history, it's generally been understood that covetousness is a problem that affects people. So he says, as the light of nature shows, that it debases the minds of men, making them useless and exposing them to all manner of vile practices. Okay, so they're all preoccupied with what they have, and then they behave badly. That's basically what he's saying. The minds of our Western nations have been almost encouraged to be covetous and especially envious. Even it's not just in the West, I guess, but with Marxism and the way that Marxism has been really, like, we've been discipled in Marxism, flooded with it, this philosophy. And the aim of it is to make us disappointed with our condition and envious of people that have more. It tries to create some kind of envy. And we didn't have enough poverty, really, in our land. And so they brought in things like racism to try to get people to war against each other and to be envious of this other person has a better situation than I have. This kind of thing has really gone on, you know, quite a lot to disrupt our society. And it's interesting, the people who embrace Marxism the most often really don't care about how well everyone is doing. What they care about is everybody's the same. So as long as people are all brought down to the same level, it doesn't matter whether you're brought up. The goal is to bring everybody down so that they're all the same level and nobody's higher than another person, which is really very disruptive to society and to God's whole economy and way of doing things. It's proving to be very disruptive to our society, dividing us, getting us fighting and warring and factions with each other that don't really need to be there. There are many reasons that covetousness is not appropriate for Christian pilgrims. And I'm sure you can already see that. It's not appropriate for people that are going to God's house, that's their life. Okay. First of all, it is contrary to brotherly love. Remember what this chapter starts with, let brotherly love continue. Well, it's contrary to that. I'm focused on what I have, what I don't have. I don't care about my brothers. So it hinders brotherly love. Okay, second, it is inappropriate for Christian pilgrims because it spoils fellowship with its constant complaining and dissatisfaction. You know, you're around that's brought into the fellowship of God's people, complaining, dissatisfaction. It's not pleasant to be around. Simply unpleasant to listen to. Third is inappropriate because it leads us and our children into apostasy. We see this very clearly with the Israelites. They were such complainers. And we don't like what God gave us here in the wilderness. What did they have in the wilderness? They had communion with God. God was making himself known to them. They should have been delighted with that. But instead they were like, well, we've got hard things. Look at it. We've got this and we don't have that. And we had better food when we were in Egypt. And it was better for us in Egypt. God has just revealed himself to them. He's shown himself from Mount Sinai. He's shown his tabernacle and all the ways of how atonement and all of these things. And here they are unhappy with this. It led to apostasy. The people did not want to follow God. They didn't want to serve him. And it brought ruin to them. And this happens all the time. Christian parents, we focused on
you know, success, prosperity. And these are their real heart desires. And then their children are drawn into that. And they have no, God's sort of on the side. He's not really that important.
Fourth, it is inappropriate for pilgrims because it's contagious. In a way, of course, talked about that with children, but when you are discontent and unhappy with what God has given us, you're going to draw other people into that. Because you talk about, you point out all the negative things, all the problems, all the hard things, and you don't point to the things like I was just talking about with Israel. Like, you know, we're here before God. He's making himself known to us. He's shaping us to be his people. Instead, it's like, oh, well, look at that. We didn't get, oh, you know, we didn't have, look at this food. We're having to eat this manna every day. This is so disgusting. I'm so sick of this. And, you know, you're going on like that. It's going to bring other people into that. It's inappropriate, fifthly, because it spoils our witness to the world. World looks on, they say, wow, those are some unhappy people. I don't want anything to do with them. Why would I want to have a part with that? I'm going to go somewhere else. Sixth, covetousness shuts down our praise and adoration of God. Instead of seeing his goodness, we look at him as an uncaring father who doesn't give us what he ought to give us. He's unjust. There's something distorted with him, and we don't really like him, you see. This has a tendency to dry up our hope, of course, in what he has promised. Why would I want to go to him if he's like that? It's no delight in going to live in his house. I'd rather go somewhere else. And so I say that covetousness is not at all appropriate for those that are going to God's house. It does not have a place. Our goal should be contentment with our present situation. And that's the positive side. Not covetousness, not silver loving, but contentment with our present situation. This is what the words in the second phrase mean. Be content with what you have. This is a contentment or a commandment that you are to obey. There is a prevailing lie of Satan that too many Christians buy into today that has really become dominant in our society. And the lie is that you have no control over your feelings or your desires. Those are just given to you. So if you have bad feelings, good feelings, whatever, you have no control over that really. You just have, it's just a given. You can maybe take drugs to dampen them or enhance them or whatever you need to do that way. But contentment, according to the Bible, is a learned behavior. It's something that you learn. You have to learn with God's help. You look at your present condition. Okay, this is what you do to be content. You look at your present condition and you say, I will be satisfied with this. I will be satisfied with what I actually have. Okay, this is what I have presently. So I'm going to enjoy what I have presently, and I'm going to make good use of it right now. It will do me no good to wish that I had something different than what I have, because this is what I have. I will thank God, and I will be content with it. You see, that's basically you set that as your what you're going to learn to do. But as we will see, it is not just a willingness to grin and bear it. We're not talking about being Spartans here. It is a commitment to look at it in the right way and have the foundation of true joy that is not where you're just saying, well, I'm just going to put up with it, but where you actually see that your situation is a good situation. Because if you're a Christian, it is a good situation. And so therefore, if you're not content, it's because you're looking at everything in a wrong way and you're not enjoying, you're not feeling the goodness of God. You don't have a sense of his goodness because everything is out of kilter. Paul said, speaking of this as a learned behavior, he said that he had learned to be content in whatever estate he was in, whatever condition he was in, whether he had a lot or whether he had a little. I have learned to be content. If you're deprived of all comfort and in great hardship, you can be content the way an athlete is. When he's pushing his body to point of pain for greater strength, he deliberately puts himself under strain and struggle to the point of exhaustion, and he loves it. Okay, he's not there saying, oh man, I had a terrible workout because, you know, it was so hard. He says, it was a great workout. Like, I pushed to the max, you know, and in the heat of the training, he does not wish that he was somewhere else. You know, I wish I was sitting on a couch eating French fries right now. He's glad that he's there where he is. He is there in the moment, benefiting from the trial that stretches every nerve in his body. Suppose you have a hard marriage. How can you be content? Learn to love and care for your difficult spouse. Give thanks for the situation because God gave it to you. God gave it to you. It is an opportunity for you to learn to love what is not lovely. You learn to love when you have unlovely things to love. To love like Jesus did. He said, if you just love people that love you, then what have you done? You know, but you really develop and cultivate love when you are able to love those who are unlovely. It is here that you can learn to honor God, okay, and to feed upon His grace and strength so that delighting in Him, you're able to have sufficiency to love what is unlovely or what is not loving you. You can feed in the strength that Christ, feed upon Christ and have His strength. Jesus loved fallen, ruined people. Love grows in and shines in a world where it is hard to love. God has given this to you so that you can grow. Okay? You need it. Just, the athlete that does just sit around on a couch and eat French fries and never pushes his body, he's not going to be much of an athlete, is he? He needs this. He's in the moment. He's there to do what is to be done. But don't misunderstand this call to contentment. Okay, I want to clarify something here because we got so many problems. There's so many ditches that we can fall in. And this does not mean that you should not try to better your situation by honest effort. And sometimes people can go that route, that they start thinking that way when they talk about contentment. Oh, that means I'm just passive, you know. I don't try. I've got my situation. I say, well, that's what it is. I'm not going to do anything to make it better. I'm not going to try to improve. No, God has commanded us to labor for 6 days and rest on the seventh day when we worship Him. And He has instructed us to do it in order that we may provide for ourselves and have sufficiency also to provide for others. And so, really, we have been given gifts and abilities and opportunities to better our condition and that of those that we serve, those that are in our purview, and we're actually ungrateful if we don't use those gifts and abilities and if we don't use them with diligence. This is not a call to sit around and watch video games and say, this is just, or play video games and say, this is just what I am. It's no, we're to go out and to seek to improve and to do and to change things and make things better in our situation, in the world. We've been given ability to do that. There is also nothing wrong with informing others of your trials and your burdens. Though you have to be careful to do it in an appropriate way. You don't want to go into a complaining mode, which is very easy to do. But to talk to others of the struggles and the trials that you're having. Think about Paul again. Paul is such a godly man. And he often speaks of the hardships that he was under. How, you know, I was at the point of death, despair. I was despairing of life. And he does it. He also does it. He expresses appreciation for the help that he received when he was in various trials and deprivations. Sometimes he asked for help too. For example, when he wrote to Philemon, who had a runaway slave, and Paul said, you know, look, I'm going to ask you to let him go because he's useful to me in the ministry. His slave Onesimus had repented and was serving God. He said, you know, give him to me because I need him for the ministry. I'm asking you to do that as my friend. And, you know, Paul needed his help. And we are a brotherhood. And it is a loving thing to share our needs with others that they may have opportunity to help us if they are able. I would even illustrate, too, that it's something that I thought about not long ago with some of our neighbors that, you know, you have unbelieving neighbors around you. You want to minister to them. You want to do stuff for them and things like that. But don't hesitate to ask them to do stuff for you, too. That's a way of showing them that, you know, you respect them as people. You want to, you want that they can help you. There's something they can do for you. You don't have to be the one that says, well, I'm the Christian, so I always have to do. Yeah, you want to be a giver, but it's also important to bring others into your life that, in ways that they can help you. Furthermore, it is right for us to pray for relief from hard times. God promises that we're all going to be resurrected. We're all going to be delivered from every bodily infirmity. We're all going to be delivered from poverty and hardships of every single kind. And so he is pleased for us to ask him as children to, you know, take this hard thing away from me. But we also leave it with him and say, okay, but if not, give me the grace that I need to be able to serve you, and I will trust you. And then we know, if it helps us to be settled, that God intends us to have this thing. Because we ask him as a loving father to take it away, and he didn't. So therefore, we need to say, okay, he gave me this for a good, gracious purpose. But you see, the thing is, you can't have anything different than what you have right now. So why be discontent with that? What you have right now is what God has given you right now. So again, learn to be content. Say, okay, I will serve God with exactly where I am and what I have right now, the opportunities I have and everything. My portion is God himself. The person who is content is the person who is truly happy. Solomon says that the man who loves silver will never be satisfied with silver. Okay, he's always on a quest to have a little bit more. He loves it, but he never has enough of it. He can't enjoy it because it's never quite enough. The poor man, on the other hand, who is content, can find more pleasure feasting on a dry crust of bread and some brackish water, that's all he can get. That can be his feast that he delights in, while the rich man, surrounded with all of his fancy dishes and his servants waiting on him and his fancy food and fare, is discontent because there's things that are not right, and this is not my investment I had is not doing well, and this is blah, 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 blah. He's going on like that. He's got a feast. But to him, he's a poor man. The poor man's rejoicing. I got some bread. Let's have it. Let's sit down and eat. Let's give thanks to God. You see, what a difference. This epistle to the Hebrews, though, it does not stop with this. It moves on to direct us to the proper source and foundation of our contentment. And this is what I said before. You see, there's a foundation here. There's a source of this contentment. It's not just like, I'm just going to bear this. No. There's a real foundation here. I've touched on it already, but let's look at it. It's laid out for us directly here in the passage. The proper foundation for our contentment is God himself. There are, I want to say, first of all, improper foundations for contentment. To use an obvious example, a bank robber can be quite content that he has pulled off 3 very successful bank robberies, has remained undetected. He's very pleased with himself for his cleverness and being able to evade the authorities. And he's enjoying all the riches he's gotten by his bank robberies. Man, I've done really well. This is great. Okay, that's an obvious example of someone that's very content. That is not a good situation. Okay, bad foundation for his contentment. Then there is a person who maybe is a lot more positive example. He labors honestly. And he does quite well for himself, hardworking, making progress. And then he acquires wealth and he enjoys his wealth. You know, he really finds great pleasure in it. He does not want anything more than what he has. He says, man, I've got a lot. You know, I'm happy with my my house, my vacation house, and a couple cars that I have, and my boat. I love all these things. I have pretty much what I want. I travel, get to go places. This is a great life. You know, I couldn't be happier. Maybe he even goes so far as to enjoy sharing his wealth. You know, he sees somebody, maybe he sees a young couple that's struggling and starting out. He says, you know, I can help them buy a house. I'm going to give them a down payment so they can go and buy a house. And, you know, he does stuff like that. He loves it. He's living a good life. He helps a friend, give him a boost, whatever. This man's foundation is completely wrong because he glories in his riches and not in God, only in his riches. There's nothing wrong with enjoying riches, but the man glories in riches and not in God. He does not acknowledge the true God. He gains the whole world, as Jesus said, and loses his own soul. He has no interest in God. His contentment is actually his ruin. This man should be discontent because he's not reconciled with God. He should be discontent because the Most High is his judge and he's sinned against him, like we all have, and he needs to repent and be reconciled to him. He sees no need for God. He's wronged his Creator and has no desire to make things right with him. He's living in a dream world. He's an offender, and he doesn't even recognize it. He doesn't even think about it. All his happiness will be lost forever. The Lord warns us about the wrong foundation in this way in Jeremiah 9, 23 and 24, where he says to us, thus says the Lord, it says, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these I delight, says the Lord. So you see, it's possible to have contentment on the wrong foundation, but passage in Jeremiah directs us to the right foundation. Our text also directs us to the same thing, to God himself as the proper foundation and the source of our contentment. The reason that we can be content and should be content is because he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. To never leave us is, of course, simply to stay with us. And to never forsake us goes a little bit beyond that. It's not only to stay with us, but it's to continue to help us. He won't stop helping us. If you forsake someone, you can be with them, but you're not helping them. If God himself is with us, he who is the highest and best companion, we have every reason to be content. When barren Hannah wept in the Old Testament because she couldn't have a child and she would not eat, Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? How much better is the Lord to us? Why do you weep? Why are you like this? Because whatever my lot in life is, he himself has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. In other words, be content. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Where can you find a better companion than the Lord Most High? When our life is hard, it is an opportunity for us to enjoy all the more our companionship with him. When things are stripped away, then we don't have anything else. So it's a time for us to turn to our Lord. Think of what he is to us. What is it to have him with us to help us? Well, he is with you, as I've indicated already, as your best companion, the one who should be the object of your desire, your delight, and the one that you worship. Who in heaven and earth can be compared with the Lord? Do you know him that way? You see, you need to cultivate that kind of communion with God. And you, a sinner, have been reconciled to him, that that you might know him and that you might serve him and that you might have fellowship with him and his son. He has reconciled us. Why? So that we can just live, however, apart from him and not be punished? No, the whole purpose, as I say to you all the time, is so we can come to him, so that we can have active communion with him. There is every reason for contentment. We can learn to enjoy his presence in whatever circumstance we are in. You need to get to know him. Have communion. You need to read his word. You need to pray. Ask him to show himself to you, to show you his glory. Remember Moses? He saw a bit of God's glory. He actually saw a lot of God's glory. And then he said, show me your glory. I want to see more of your glory. And he kept, more glory, more glory. Those who see God's glory want to see more of it. They have a delight in him. Okay, he is also with you. That was as a companion. He's also with you as a helper. He is there to strengthen you and enable you to bear that hardship. Whatever temptation has come to you, whatever trial, whatever deprivation you're experiencing, God is your helper in that. And what better helper can you have than God Almighty? He has the ability to uphold you. He can actually strengthen your spirit. He can renew your mind. He will not allow Satan or anyone else to harm you either. Yes, they may persecute, they may even take your life. But if you're resting in the Lord, it will not harm you. Dying does not harm you. You just go to be with God then sooner. Nothing they do will hurt you. It can only benefit you. No loss that you bear will hurt you if God is your helper. So that's why you can be content with whatever. He is also with you as your comforter. Now that's similar, but a little different. Do you remember what we learned about the Lord Jesus in Hebrews 4, 15 and 16? Something we don't think about enough. I said it at the time. This is something we really need to recognize. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. He is a man. He became flesh. He is God who became flesh, the God-man. And he is a man of perfect compassion because he is a perfect man. He doesn't have the kind of compassion that we have that's not all that great. He truly does weep with those that weep. And he truly rejoices with those that rejoice because he truly loves us. He loves us like nobody else. He is not indifferent at any time to our affliction. He is not at all indifferent to our affliction. He sympathizes with us in all of our infirmities. You say, then why doesn't he deliver us? Why doesn't he take it away? He doesn't deliver us because he knows that we need the sufferings. He has designed them. He sends them to us in his wisdom. He is like a good coach who pushes us to our best. I talked about the athlete before. Think of a parent who does everything for their child and gives them everything they want whenever they want it. That parent does not love their child. That parent is the ruin of their child. The one who recognizes that their children need to endure hard things, need to be given hard tasks, need to be have things that stretch them. There is no better way to destroy a child than that. But this does not mean that he is aloof, you see, where he knows it's best for us. And, well, it's the best thing for you. Bear with it. No, he sympathizes with us, and he comes and says, come to me, pour out your heart to me. I'm here to encourage you. I'm here to help you. I've been there. I went to the cross. He suffered more than any of us will ever suffer. He suffered for us. Our contentment will come when we can respond to what he himself has said. Okay, I will never leave you or forsake you. That's what he said. Now, he can just say that and can be floating around there. I need to take that. What does that mean? I will never leave you or forsake you. We just talked about what that means. So what do we say? Verse 6, it lays it out. Let me start with verse 5 again to pick up the flow. Okay, Hebrews 13:5 from the middle of verse 5. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we may boldly say, confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? We need to receive the truth and confess the truth if we're to benefit from the truth. If you don't receive the truth by faith, if you don't confess the truth, then it's not going to help you. He tells us that he will never leave us or forsake us, and we must say from the depths of our heart, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? We must say that in the depths of our soul, okay, not just with our lips. Say it in your heart, but we must say it to our Christian companions. The Lord is my helper. You see, I will not fear. The Lord is my help. We encourage others in our affliction when we say that. And we encourage ourselves. We help ourselves. We affirm it. We must say that to our persecutors. Like Daniel's friends did with King Nebuchadnezzar when he told them that if they wouldn't bow down to his silly statue that he had set up, that they would have to be cast into the fiery furnace. And they basically said, I'm not going to fear what man can do to me. The Lord is my helper. If he wants to deliver me, he can deliver me. I'm not afraid of this. We say it to our persecutors. We bring God into the picture in their purview as well. Daniel, of course, similar thing with the lion's den. When we receive his promise and confess it, it will go a long way in helping us to be content in whatever our situation is, and it will glorify God for us to say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Much of it comes down to trust. Okay, when we get down to the very foundation of it, what do you think of God? What do you think of him? Do you trust him? Do you believe the things that God says? Or is it kind of like not real? You know, is God not really real? We must trust that he will indeed be with us. We must trust that he is able to deliver us. He has no limitations. We must trust that he has not forsaken us and that he is not forsaking us in the moment and that he will not forsake us in the future. But this trust is defective unless it includes trust that he has our best interests at heart. Okay? That he has put us right where we are with the very best of intentions. That he is truly kind and gracious. Do you believe that about God? He is the most kind, the most gracious of all. And that he has designed the situation just for us, whatever it is, whatever the right now situation is, he has designed with perfect wisdom and with the tenderest of love. Do you believe that about God? Or do you see him as something different than what God has revealed? When that is believed, that will bring contentment to whatever your situation is. It has a true foundation. It's not just gritting your teeth. So do you see how it is not just a grin and bear or be a Spartan? It is rather an intelligent response to the one who truly loves you more than anyone else. He is truly kind and gracious. He has designed this situation just for me, you need to say, with perfect wisdom and with perfect love. It is hard, but it is good. And let me add, this is also the case when your situation is delightful. I have to put that in too. Because he hasn't forsaken you when it's delightful either. And sometimes it seems like we have a harder time with when everything is going well than we do when everything is going wrong. Most Christians actually do far better when they're under struggles as far as their communion with God than when everything's going well. It doesn't need to be that way, but it often is that way. But he does not forsake us in those times either when everything is well, so that we can boldly say in those times, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? He can keep us when we prosper if we will trust him. He is with us, and we must look to him as our companion in our prosperity. That's where we fail. Our prosperity, we get so caught up with our prosperity and what's happening, this is great, this, oh, look at this, that we forget to thank God. We forget to have communion with him in enjoying what he has given us. So We must look to him as our companion in our prosperity, our companion who rejoices with us. He delights to see us rejoice, who has given us all things to enjoy, who wants to have fellowship with us in our enjoyment of the good things that he has given us, who is giving us a foretaste of the glory of his house to come. You can rejoice in what God... You don't need to feel guilty that everything's going well sometimes and that you have a lot of blessings and things like that. You can rejoice and have communion with God in the blessing. We're always supposed to have communion with God, who said, I will never leave you or forsake you. He doesn't forsake you when everything's going well, nor does he forsake you when it's not. So instead of forgetting him in our prosperity, let us learn to enjoy him and give thanks to him and find him better than all of his best gifts. Okay? Kind of said, am I not 10 times better to you than a child would be? You know, I love you, I'm your husband, I care for you. Am I not sufficient for you? Yes, and our deprivations. But also when we have all of these wonderful things, we need to see God is better still. We live in him, before him. Brothers and sisters, our entire pilgrimage is about communion with the Lord. That's what we're going to, is communion with the Lord. That's what we live in as we go on the pathway. We're going to him as brothers and sisters on the way that Christ has opened for us, looking to Jesus as our helper all the way. There is no place for covetousness on this road. There are solid grounds for contentment. There is no place for wanting to be somewhere else and have something else than exactly what God has given you if you're one of his people. We have what is best. We have our Heavenly Father, and we have his Son, our Savior. Let us go forward trusting him and walking in fellowship with him in the hard times and in the good times. The Lord is our helper. He will never leave us or forsake us. Please stand and let's call on his name. O Lord our God, it is our great desire to have communion with you. For you are the God who is worthy of all praise and honor. You are the true God, the one who made heaven and earth and everything in them. You're the one who rules over all, who is sovereign. You're the one who is perfectly wise, perfectly holy, perfectly gracious, very, very kind, very merciful, also full of holiness and judgment and justice, truth, righteousness. You're the one who never does wrong. And we praise you, O Lord, that with your children, that you take delight in them, that you bring them into your fellowship, that you save them, that you wash away their sins through the blood of your Son, and that you make us to be more and more like you, O Lord, to be conformed to the image of your Son, that we will be those who learn how to love and how to serve, learn how to love you, who grow in that love, who grow in our fellowship and our walk with you. O Lord, have mercy on us. We are aliens. We're alienated too much from you, Lord. We don't really know what it is to have communion with you, to delight in you, to be those who want more than anything to see more of your glory, because we've seen your glory to start with. We've got a taste of it. We pray, Lord, that you would give us a rich, rich taste of your glory as we go along in our pilgrim way. We pray that we would see who you are, that you would indeed be a companion to us that we reach out to, Lord, that we walk with, that we look to in our deepest distresses as well as our greatest prosperity. We pray that ever, always, we would have communion with you. And we pray, Lord, that you would also be our helper, for we need your grace, O Lord, in our trials and our difficulties. We look to Jesus, the one who is able to lift us up, the one who also is our comforter. And we pray that you would be that to us as well, that we would come to know you, O Lord, to delight in you, to be pleased with you, that we would be pleased with whatever our lot in life is right now, right at this time, that we would know, Lord, that this is from your hand. It is designed by a God who loves us and who is doing what is best for us. Oh, Father, it doesn't matter really whatever happens to us in this world, for you are bringing us to your house of glory. And the way that you bring us is the way that is good, the way that you have designed. We pray, O Lord, that we would trust you. That is our problem, Lord. We don't trust that you are a good and gracious God to your children. we have doubts about that. We question that, and it makes us discontent. We pray that you would help us, Lord. There is no place for discontentment. We pray that we would have a full contentment, knowing that the Lord is our helper, because you have said, I will never leave you or forsake you. Oh, Lord, we rest in you. Bless us all. Help us to encourage each other. Help us to love each other. We're pilgrims together on this road. We're not running down this road by ourselves. We're with a whole company of your people. And we pray that we would encourage other people to walk with you, to know you, that we would point them to the hope that we have, to your goodness, to your glory, that you can be trusted. Help us, Lord, to be diligent in doing that. Oh, Lord, help us to love others the way you have loved us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Receive now the blessing of the Lord our God. And now may the Lord supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.